Well, in our Bible binge, which has been our 4 or 12 month journey so far, we got 2 months ago, we are finally in one of the most interesting books of the Bible. They're all interesting. They're all important. They all matter. But if there's a book that I get asked more often about to do a Bible study, to explain, to do a sermon series about, it's Revelation. There's something about Revelation that piques our interest. If you've been reading it, we're a few chapters in already. We're already into chapter 11 we've gotten through so far. In fact, as you were probably hearing the liturgy this morning, you're like, I think I read this week in my Bible. You did. That what we were seeing there, you know, before the Lamb and, you know, all of that comes right from Revelation. We'll get to our communion liturgy. You'll say, you know what, I think I read this in my Bible this week too, and you did. There's something about this revelation language, this vision, especially of what is yet to come in the presence of Christ that just, that intrigues us. Now, it's also Revelation, one of the most abused, misunderstood, misquoted, misinterpreted, you name it, it's been done to the book of Revelation, abused and twisted and turned for various reasons. And part of that is because the language that's used, the type of literature Revelation is written in, it's a apocalyptic literature, which means it's unlike other books of the scriptures. Sure, there's a little bit of apocalyptic literature in Daniel, which we just finished, which is why it was just before this, and there was some in Ezekiel as well. But it's not like the other Old Testament books, it's not like the Gospels or the letters of Paul that we read about. It's different. In fact, it's so different that sometimes it's so hard to understand that we can miss the forest for the trees, so to speak, when it comes to Revelation. And we can miss, especially, what the big picture of the book of Revelation is all about. I'd like to illustrate it for you this morning in a different way. I have some puzzle pieces here. I took one of my kids' puzzles last night, and don't tell them. I brought some puzzle pieces here because I want to use an illustration to help you figure this out. So I'm going to give a couple. Keith, I'm going to give you a piece here. All right, there you go. Help me out. There we go. We need some pieces. Now study these pieces very, very carefully. Got to get some over here as well because we got some really smart people on this side of the church as well. So, all right. So now I want you to look at those puzzle pieces, and this is really easy, so you can figure this out right away. What's the puzzle picture? What's it about? He's still studying. Everybody else gave up really quick. He's like, I'm going to figure this out. Now, you know what it's a picture of? I bet you if I would have handed it out and back, you guys would have figured it out. No, those puzzle pieces, it's a picture of a peacock, of course. There it is, but I had it upside down. So it's a picture of a peacock. My daughter loves peacocks, and that's a 1,000-piece puzzle piece from this peacock puzzle. Now do you know what it looks like, right? You see, when you have just a little piece of the puzzle, you look at the piece, and you kind of say, I don't know what this is. But I bet you could have come up with some pretty good ideas about what that piece could go to. And you would probably be wrong. I don't think everybody thought it was a multicolored peacock, unless you were here at last night's service and you got the head start on this. That's what it's a piece of. And I think sometimes when we read Revelation, hold on to those pieces or put them on the end. I got to get those back because otherwise you know what it's like missing puzzle pieces in doing a 1,000-piece puzzle. But I think Revelation can sometimes be like that. I want you to understand it, that we can get too focused on what does this mean? What does this represent? Who is this person? When did this event happen? When will this event happen? What's this mark? What's this seal? We go all over into the little details and you miss the big picture. And the big picture is Jesus wins. And those who are in Christ Jesus win too. It's a victory celebration. It's a joy. And we can look at all the details and we can look at all the other things. And maybe we'll do that in the new year. We'll have a Bible study and we'll dig into it. But we'll have to understand that when we're looking at apocalyptic literature, there's a lot of times, there's multiple meanings, there's layers. That's part of the beauty of it. And as it tries to describe the cosmic reality happening in the spiritual warfare around us with earthly terms, it sometimes gets a little confusing. And so when we read Revelation, if we read Revelation as kind of as if we got the secret decoder ring from our Cracker Jack box, and we pulled it out and we're figuring it all around, and oh, this means that, this means this. If you're reading it as something you've got to figure out and decode everything, you're reading Revelation wrong. You're reading it wrong. It's not a play-by-play. It's not a here's what happens and now I can know what the next step is. No, the focus of everything that's going on in this book of Revelation, and especially if you're the first audience who's getting this, if you're the audience that the Apostle John has been sent to, he's on the island of Patmos, he gets this vision from Jesus because the church is hurting. The church is suffering. Jesus said he was coming back, and they're crying out, "Where are you, Jesus? Come quickly, Lord Jesus, come quickly, because it's hard, and people are dying, and we're being persecuted for following you, and we thought it would be better than this. We thought life with you, Jesus, and your kingdom, we would be victorious, and we would be these conquerors, and everybody else would submit to us, but instead, we're finding ourselves imprisoned and beaten and wondering, is it all worth it? How does this end?" And John comes back from Patmos with a vision of how it ends. And Jesus wins, and the Lamb's on his throne. So when we read the book of Revelation, if we don't read the book of Revelation as something that encourages us, yes, there's some scary stuff in there, no doubt about it, but that's not the focus. The focus is the reminder that when the scary stuff comes, we're not going to ourselves as followers of Jesus and saying, "I never saw that coming. I thought life would be great and grand and perfect as a follower of Jesus." No, it's going to be hard. It's going to be tough. There will be persecutions. There will be hardship. There will be toil. And let that not surprise us, because the story's not over yet. And we know how it's going to end. Jesus wins. And those who are in Christ Jesus win too. So as we dig into the book of Revelation this morning, it's kind of perfect. It was one of those goose pimple things going on again when I was looking at the Bible binge and how we had it all laid out. And then we didn't intentionally do this. I've told you like this probably 10 times about how these coincidences or God winks kind of happen along the way, that we're reading Revelation at the same time we're celebrating All Saints Day, at the same time we're worried and anxious about the things happening around us, about something. I guess there's something happening on Tuesday. Kids have school off. I don't know why, but there's some things going on in our world that get us all riled up, and we forget we're on the winning team sometimes. We're on Team Jesus, and his kingdoms aren't of this world. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's the Lamb of God who's taken away the sins of the world for you, and we win. So as we dig into the book of Revelation this morning, as we observe All Saints Day, I want to encourage you. I put it on there this morning. I almost didn't give you this. I've been giving you these all along, these outlines from the Bible Project. You can watch their video later. Even looking at the cover, you're like, this is why I don't like Revelation. Don't miss the big picture. You can see images and scenes like this, but to remind ourselves that when it comes to the book of Revelation, and this is a key thing to understand too, this isn't something we're just simply waiting for, but whether we're also living in. That we've been living in the end times since Christ has ascended into heaven. That's our belief. The end times has been something that we have been in as the church. The age of the church is in the end times. And it's not going to always get easier. A lot of times it's going to get worse. So it doesn't surprise us, because we know the best is yet to come in the presence of Jesus. And so as we dig into Revelation this morning, we're going to go to Revelation 7. And I want to go back a little bit in Revelation 7, because there are some significant numbers. The numbers kind of matter. They're representative. They're not to be taken literally. It's apocalyptic literature. So they're symbols. They mean something. And we heard Caroline read for us today that the Bible passage started in Revelation 7, verse 9. It said, "After this." And so hopefully as good Bible scholars, you're thinking to yourself, uh-oh, something's been taken out of context. Something happened before this. And I want to tell you what happened before this. And what happened before this, John sees this vision of the church militant. And it's a church militant because there's 144,000 people that he sees, this crowd that could be numbered. It's a representative number. We don't need to dig into that. But simply to tell you this means it's a definitive group of people for a definitive time on a definitive purpose. And that purpose is to continue on, to carry on the mission that Jesus has left for the church. We've got work to do, and so we march in step, heading to battle, carrying out the work God has given us to do, making disciples of all nations, calling people from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light of the Son of the God who takes away the sin of the world. I appreciate it too. This week I spent some time with a commentary I really love. One of my favorite commentaries is Dr. Louis Brighton's commentary on Revelation. And he helps us explain these 144,000, and we see a little bit of what's going on there. He says, in this scene of 144,000, John sees God's people on earth as they're ready to carry out their mission and enter the valley of the shadow of death. But before the onslaught, he sees them sealed. John is comforted and encouraged by this sealing. For it means that no matter how much he and God's people on earth suffer, as they fulfill the mission of their Lord, God will protect them in their faith. And when in the second scene he sees the church triumphant, those coming out of the great tribulation and suffering, he's filled with joy and enthusiasm. The church militant will suffer and die in the Lord's mission, but she will not lose faith, for her God will defend her in that faith. And in the end, the church militant will become the church triumphant. There is hope. In this scene that John sees of this 144,000, this church carrying out the work that God would have them to do. And they don't just go out there willy-nilly thinking they got it all under control, thinking they can do it by their own power, own strength. No, John notices, and Dr. Brighton mentioned it there too, that these people, that they're sealed. And this seal that they're sealed in is by God himself. Brighton continues on later on in that same chapter and talking about what that seal is. And he says, thus the Spirit of God in his gracious activity through God's word and the sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper seals God's people so that they know they belong to God and that he will protect them in their faith in the midst of all their tribulations they endure. You have been sealed by God's word. And God's word connected to real things, sealed in the waters of your baptism, where God himself said, that's my chosen daughter. That's my beloved son with whom I am well pleased. I am sealing them. I am choosing them and giving them a new name as my beloved child. That seal will be strengthened this morning as we come to his table and he feeds us with his very body and blood as words and promises declare. It's just simple bread and it's just simple wine, but God connects his word to it and he seals you and me in it because he knows the strife is hard. The battle is long. We need his strength and his power for when the nights are weary and we wonder, are we still on the right path? It's difficult. Is this still the right direction? And Jesus comes and reminds us who we are, chosen, sealed in his word, made very his very own saints and the water and the word of our baptism. So now you know who he's looking at. He sees this church militant. But he doesn't just see the church militant. He sees the church triumphant in that scene in Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. And he says it this way. He says, after this I looked, and there was a vast multitude from every nation, tribe, people, and language, which no one could number, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. And they were clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, crying out, salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb. Sounds kind of familiar a little bit. Who is this crowd? This crowd, they look different. They're not all the same. Different skin colors, different languages, different people groups, different tribes. But they're all dressed the same. They may have some differences in their appearance, but they're all dressed the same. Because they all got to this place the same way. Washing their robes in the blood of the Lamb, as John will later be told in that same passage. They're dressed the same because they got there the same way. Not by their own strength, not by their own power, not by their good works, not by how strong or mighty they were or how righteous they kept God's law. They got there because they've been clothed in the blood of the Lamb of God who took away the sin of the world. That's what John the Baptist said one day. He saw Jesus passing by, and yeah, Jesus was his cousin, but he didn't call him cousin. He didn't call him Jesus. He called him the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And that's what he did. And here in Revelation, we see that lamb on a throne. Because while that lamb would go to the cross to sacrifice his life, to pour out his blood, to cover the sins of the world and your sins and my sins as well, he's not just the lamb, but he's also the shepherd. And as the shepherd, he knows how to lead his people home. For he himself is that way, that truth, and that life. So we remember. We remember those faces in that crowd, even this very day, who this last year have gone to Jesus and are before the throne of the Lamb, clothed in white, with palm branches in their hands. Let's remember some of them right now. And one of the elders asked me, who are these people in white robes? Where do they come from? And I said to him, sir, you know. Then he told me, these are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. These are the ones who have gone before us. And they've gone before us in faith, with the confidence that because Jesus lives, they too live. You know, we only see palm branches appearing two times in the scriptures, in the New Testament. The first time is one you probably think of, Palm Sunday. And we think of the people there as Jesus rode in from Bethany into Jerusalem, cutting down palm branches as that procession came closer, as they see Lazarus, who had just been raised by Jesus a few days, weeks earlier, around that time, very much back alive, leading that procession, Jesus riding on a donkey and people waving those palm branches, putting them on the floor, shouting out, Hosanna, which means, Lord, save us. And they thought he was coming to save them of a kingdom of this world, to save them from the Roman tyranny, to save them from those who would oppress them. And when it turned out that Jesus had a different mission in mind, the crowd turns their back on him. And instead of calling out, Hosanna, they call out, crucify him. Not understanding that this Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world is going to the cross. And that instead of just being a symbol of suffering and death and punishment, he would transform it to a symbol of life and forgiveness and salvation. They didn't get it then, but they get it now. And they wave those palm branches because they understand that the Lamb of God is on his throne. He is ruling and reigning. He is mighty in battle. He is victorious over sin. He has defeated Satan. He has defeated even death itself. So they sing his praises. And they sing his praises because in his presence, this is a great scene, this presence that John describes. And I love this description that John tells us. He gives us kind of in some places in Revelation a picture of what's yet to come in heaven and in the new creation and in the resurrection of the dead. But many times, because this is a scene of perfection, he can't even fully grasp and describe it for you. I know for you and for me, if you're going to go stay someplace, if you're going to go somewhere, you're going to look at the reviews. If you're going to make a reservation in a hotel, you're going to go on a vacation, you're going to see, okay, if I'm staying in an Airbnb, what are the amenities? What, is there going to be a pool there? What do I need to bring? All these kind of things we look at when we plan when we're making a trip. But when we're making this ultimate trip that Jesus is going to take us on, John's going to spend more time telling us what's not there because that's we can understand. That we can understand because the brokenness of this world, we want it to be gone. And so he describes it so beautifully in Revelation chapter 7. He continues on in there in verse 15. He said, for this reason, they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple, and the one seated on the throne will shelter them. And then he tells us what's not there. They will no longer hunger. They will no longer thirst. The sun will no longer strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb is at the center of the throne, will shepherd them. He will guide them to springs of the waters of life. And God will wipe every tear from their eyes. So get your crying in now. Because where you're going, you're not going to need them. That beautiful scene that John gives us of that foretaste of that feast to come. We can't imagine what it's going to be like. So John tells us what's not going to be there. And those things being gone, oh, that sounds good. That sounds really good. And while we wait for that day, we recognize that we're not there yet. Our picture is in the Bible, but it's not just in this church triumphant. Our picture is in that 144,000. We're in the church militant. We're living in the midst of the work that God has given us to do as his church. We get to live in the assurance of the outcome's been established. We know how it's going to end. We know Jesus himself says it in his word in the Gospel of John chapter 14. He says, I'm going to go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will return so that where I am, you may be also. He's got it figured out, the end game. And so let me ask you this, if you know how the story ends, if you've seen a picture how the story ends described by John, if you've seen the promises of Jesus who's faithful to his people and faithful to his promise, if you know how the outcome is going to end, it's sure and certain. How does it impact how you live today? Think of it this way. Some of you this afternoon, you're going to waste your time because you're going to watch the NFL games this afternoon, right? It's just a waste of time. Men hitting one another, right? Just weird. All right, we'll look back on that in some day and say, we did what? Okay. But I'm going to enjoy watching some of the games too. But if you knew the outcome of these games this afternoon, I'm not a betting man, nor am I encouraging you to bet. But if you knew for certain, other than, I mean, you can know for certain the Cowboys are going to lose, but I mean, if you knew all the other games for certain, if you knew for sure what was going to happen, and you knew the outcome was sure, and you had a little bit of extra money to throw around, you would find every penny you could. You'd throw some money down, and you make some money because your bet, you were making a sure bet. It was a guaranteed bet. In this world, there's no guaranteed bets, but if you knew the outcome, oh boy, look out. We know the outcome. Not of something trivial like an NFL game, but of this world and of our lives. And the big picture is Jesus wins. And those who are in Christ Jesus, they win too. And so if the certainty of your eternity is secure and certain because of Jesus, how does it impact what we did as the body of Christ, as a church collectively and individually? Are we all in on the mission of Jesus? Because that's why you're still here. To be a part of his work in this world. To carry out the things that he's prepared for you to walk in. The works that needed not for him, but for your neighbor. For the people that God is perfectly positioning in your life. You are here to bring light to the darkness, to bring hope to the hopeless, to bring healing to the hurting, to bring comfort to the grieving, because we've got an outcome that has been written for sure and for certain. And bringing that message is going to cost something. It's the cost of discipleship. And a number of times, Jesus says that cost is going to be pretty high. I put the Gospel of Luke on the screen this morning, and this is from Luke chapter 9, but I want you to know that this is one of the sayings of Jesus that he says multiple times in every single gospel, sometimes more than once. And I wish he hadn't had said this. I wish he would have said, if you follow me, life will be hashtag blessed, and everything will be super great. But instead, he gave me reality. And Jesus said, if anyone wants to follow after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life because of me will save it. For what does it benefit someone if he gains the whole world and yet loses or forfeits himself? Count the cost. And Jesus says, the cost of following me is worth it. It might seem different than the way of this world because you got to lose to win. You got to lay down in order to be raised up. But trust me, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and life. I know where I'm going, and I can lead you home. So follow me. Follow me when the world seems crazy and chaotic. Follow me when you think the world is out of control. Follow me in the midst of things in this world that seem chaotic and in the midst of uncertainties, in the midst of all these things, you can follow me because I know the way home and I know the outcome is sure. When John gets that vision in Revelation chapter 7 of that heavenly scene, it's not the only time he sees that. Because in the midst of him seeing all of these difficult and hard things, God in his mercy shows John that picture again. And he shows him that picture again there at the end of the book of Revelation. It's in chapter 21. And I want you to imagine this for a moment. I'm going to read these words, but maybe just close your eyes. Or if you've been sleeping, open your eyes. Do the opposite of what you're doing. And I want you to imagine this scene. Who do you see up there? Who's around this throne? Imagine for a moment. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared like a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne. Look, God's dwelling is with humanity. He will live with them. They will be his peoples. God himself will be with them and will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Grief, crying, and pain will be no more, because the previous things have passed away. And the Lamb seated on the throne said, look, I am making everything new. Write this down, because these words are faithful and true. It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will freely give to the thirsty from the spring of the water of life. Amen. Come quickly, Lord Jesus. Come quickly. Amen.